I guess we'll go ahead and get started. So, welcome to the two of you. My name is Dr. Tom Dayag. I'm a professor at Broward College in the BSN program. And since 2002, I had an interest, actually in 1996, I had an interest in preparing nurses for the Nclex. And I used to own a review center for the Nclex internationally. So, I had mostly students from the Philippines, from India, as well as in other areas like in England, in London, as well as in Canada, where I presented Nclex courses. And so it's my pleasure and privilege to be with you today because I wanted to assist you to be successful in the Nclex. So I know that you probably are already aware that the Nclex is going to have new generation type of questions, which includes case studies. And that's exactly what we're going to do today and the next 8 days or 9 days. And there are topics or case studies that I think are going to be high yield or high probability of them coming out in the Nclex. And so we begin our case studies today with acute coronary syndrome. And the way that I do this is I present the material, and after which we're going to go to a case study, and you can also go back to that case study and answer it yourself again in order to review one more time before you take the Nclex. So welcome. So let's begin with acute coronary syndrome. As you know, acute coronary syndrome begins with the underlying cause being atherosclerosis, and atherosclerosis is known also as coronary heart disease. And what happens in atherosclerotic heart disease is that lipids, calcium, fibrin, and other cellular substances are deposited in the lining of the arteries, as illustrated over here, and eventually causes injury not only to the inner lining of the artery, which is the endothelium, but also triggers an inflammatory process. And this inflammatory process builds a plaque, and this plaque eventually becomes ruptures, I should say, and it causes occlusion of the coronary arteries. And that's exactly what happens as far as acute coronary syndrome is concerned. So when this particular event occurs, there's going to be occlusion of the coronary arteries. And whenever there is occlusion of the coronary arteries, what's going to happen is that there's going to be death of cardiac tissue in approximately 10 seconds. So the correct answer here is 10 seconds. And I just wanted to illustrate this or to display the question so that you are going to be able to go back to it later on, in as much as this is videotaped. So once again, welcome to all of you who are joining us to this class. And my name is Dr. Tom Badayag, and I will be your facilitator for this course. All right, what causes coronary heart disease? Well, there are several risk factors that are going to be common for this to occur. And they could be non-modifiable risk factors, or they could be modifiable risk factors. And I think you are familiar with what the modifiable are, the things that we can change, those factors that are going to be changed. And they include the following right over here: smoking, hypertension, dyslipidemia, diabetes, obesity, metabolic syndrome, inactivity, and alcohol. And I must also add, in addition to alcohol, one of our major problems here in the United States is cocaine abuse. And so it is also a modifiable risk factor. And the reason why cocaine causes acute coronary syndrome is that it could lead to vasospasm, and severe vasospasms could cause cardiac death. Now, there are also non-modifiable risk factors, and we cannot choose our parents or our genetic components. So, family history is going to be very important. And then, of course, age. whenever we have individuals, a family have a age of 55 for men is going to be one of the most common occurrences of acute coronary syndrome. And so women are not as at risk at an early age. However, at the age of 65, they begin to be equal now with men. And therefore, what's going to happen is that the occurrence of acute coronary syndrome is going to be equal then after the age of 65. So again, I mentioned that it is going to be much more common in individuals that are going to be men, but at the age of 65, it's going to be equal. And then, of course, gender. As I said, men are going to be predisposed first, and then socioeconomic factors. Now, how do socioeconomic factors contribute to a risk of acute coronary syndrome? Well, we all know that in people who are poorer or lesser socioeconomic background, they're going to have poor nutritional habits, and therefore that's the reason why they're going to be at risk. Okay, so one of those modifiable factors that we talk about is hypertension. So I wanted to ask you to answer this question. So if you could just type your answers onto the chat box, I would appreciate it. The treatment for hypertension is recommended when blood pressure is greater than what? Okay, so type your answers on the chat box and then we'll discuss. Okay, so I know that evidence-based practice is going to be a very important component of nursing. So in 2017, the guidelines for high blood pressure in adults were revised by the American College of Cardiology and the American Heart Association. And they're going to recommend, or they recommend, that treatment it has to be started when blood pressure is elevated, and they define elevation as a blood pressure that is going to be greater than 120 to 129 with a diastolic of over 80 millimeters of mercury. So the correct answer here is letter A. And so whenever you have a blood pressure that's going to be 130, for example, 122 or 130, then the recommendation is that there's got to be a treatment with non-pharmacologic interventions and lifestyle changes. So the first intervention for hypertension is going to be your lifestyle changes and non-pharmacologic interventions, including counseling with diet and so on and so forth. Now, whenever the blood pressure is greater than 130, the new recommendations is that we should begin pharmacologic treatment. So this is going to prevent the complications that are going to be associated with hypertension. Okay? So the correct answer here is letter A. All right. So another risk factor for the development of acute coronary syndrome is going to be hyperlipidemia. So I'm going to have this thing again over here, and I'm going to ask you to answer the question. Okay, so the correct answer here is that we have two types of LDL. One is going to be, lipoproteins, I should say. One is going to be LDL, which is low density lipoprotein. And the other one is HDL, which is high density lipoprotein. So to remember which one is a good lipoprotein, always think of H as heavenly lipoprotein. So HDL is the good lipoprotein and LDL is the bad lipoprotein. So HDL is heavenly, which means to say that it is a good type of lipoprotein. But look, going back to now, what is the goal as far as LDLs are concerned in order to prevent the development of coronary heart disease? Well, the goal of statin therapy is to achieve an LDL level that is going to be less than 100 milligrams per deciliter. So letter A is going to be the correct response over here. So I want you to remember that because this is a very high yield question as far as Nclex is concerned. Now, whenever we give statins to patients, we always want to make sure that we supplement it with dietary modification, as well as weight management and also exercise. Now, obesity is another risk factor for the development of acute coronary syndrome. So, having said that, then, if you are going to be counseling patients, you have to talk to them as far as ideal body mass index is concerned. So, please answer this question. Okay, so the correct answer here is letter B. Now, I said that obesity is a well-documented risk factor for coronary heart disease, and therefore weight management programs and information on healthy eating calorie intake should be promoted. And the body mass index of a patient, as well as the waist circumference, should be measured at each visit. Now, the goal is to maintain a body mass index of 18.5 to 24.9, but I must also add waist circumference because this is also going to be very important in teaching patients prevention of coronary heart disease. Now, for women, the ideal waist circumference is 35 inches. And for men, the ideal waist circumference is 40 inches. So these are our goals, 35 for women and 40 in men. All right. So again, those are some of the things that you should include in your health teaching as far as patients with coronary heart disease is concerned. Okay, so whenever we have a patient with an acute coronary syndrome, we're talking about three different things. So let me just blank the screen because I'm going to be writing something. And so when we have acute coronary syndrome, it actually is describing three different situations. And one is what's called STEMI. And the other one is called non-STEMI. And the other one is called unstable angina pectoris, or UAP. So there are three things that comprises acute coronary syndrome. Now, what's STEMI? STEMI is a form of myocardial infarction. There are two types of myocardial infarction. So I'm going to illustrate those types of myocardial infarction. by drawing the ventricles because they're the ones that are going to be affected the most. Now, if the damage as a result of occlusion of coronary arteries results from damage from the endocardial layer to the epicardial layer, which means to say that we're going to damage the full thickness of the ventricles, this results in stemi. Now, there are also other situations, though, wherein the myocardial infarction or the damage from coronary occlusion only occurs underneath the endocardium or subendocardially or subepicardially or in the middle. And therefore, this is not going to cause ST segment elevation in the electrocardiogram. This is going to result in non-stemi. So do you see now the difference? Which one is more serious? Is it stemi or non-stemi? Please answer in the chat box, or you could unmute yourself and tell me what you think. Okay, so very good. The situation of stemi means to say that there is extensive damage of the myocardium. And that is why later on, when we go to actions, we're going to focus more on critically addressing the interventions for stemi. Okay? All right. So why are they all called acute coronary syndrome? Well, the acute coronary syndrome is going to refer to the idea that the patient presents with common symptoms. And those symptoms are going to be primarily chest pain, which is going to be one that is described as a pressure-like pain. Okay, so let's go now to unstable angina pectoris. In unstable angina pectoris, there's also chest pain, but there's not going to be damage in the ventricles. There's just going to be lack of oxygen in some area of the heart, but it does not cause death of cardiac tissue. So the characteristics, therefore, are in stemi, there's going to be a rise in cardiac troponin or biomarkers that indicates that there has been death of cardiac tissue. In non-stemi, because there's also damage of cardiac tissue, there's also going to be an increase in the enzyme that is released when there's going to be death of cardiac tissue, and that is known as cardiac troponin. In an unstable angina pectoris, there is no enzyme or no biomarker that's going to indicate cardiac death. So those are the differences so far as the three things that comprises acute coronary syndrome. So with stemi, you are going to have an increase in cardiac troponin. In non-stemi, you will also have an increase in cardiac troponin. In unstable angina pectoris, you do not have a significant rise in cardiac troponin. Now, what else distinguishes these things? Well, as you could see, ST elevation MI. That means to say that the ECG shows ST elevation. And I will illustrate that later on. However, in patients with non-stemi, their ECG are not going to have any ST elevations at all. However, they will have ST depression. As well as T wave inversion. And in unstable angina, their ECG are also going to reflect ST depression and T wave inversion. All right, so review. In STEMI, do you have ST elevation in the ECG? Yes or no? Yes, okay, so this is true, okay. How about in non-STEMI? Will you have ST elevation in the ECG? No, okay, so that's negative. In unstable angina pectoris, will you have ST elevation in the ECG? No, okay, very good. How about cardiac enzymes? Which one of them is going to be troponin? Will you have it in STEMI? Yes, okay, very good. Will you have it in non-STEMI? Yes, very good. Will you have it in unstable angina pectoris? No, okay, very good. So those are the differentiations as far as the three types of ACS is concerned. So let's take a look at this question. Type in your answers. Okay, so the pain that is associated with ACS, regardless of age, gender, race, ethnicity, is going to be a pain that is diffuse, and it is always described as a pressure-like pain. And some patients will say, I feel like an elephant is sitting on my chest. They also say, I feel like a truck has been sitting on my chest. So chest pain related to ACS usually is going to be a pressure type pain, which is confined in the substernal area or epigastric area. And it may begin abruptly and could last up to 15 to 20 minutes. The duration of pain going to vary among patients. So these are going to be the classic signs of ACS. Now, there is sometimes, though, that the pain that is described by individuals is going to be different. In particular, women and the elderly. In the women and the elderly, their pain is not, or the manifestation, I should say, of acute coronary syndrome is not going to be the classic type of chest pain. They might have other symptoms such as not feeling good, or they're going to be short of breath, or they're nauseated, or they might have pain somewhere else. So that is what's called atypical chest pain. So let's go to the next question. Which pain locations is considered to be atypical in patients with ACS? Yes, like acid reflux, like they feel like they're having GERD or gastroesophageal reflux disease. All right, so what's your answer? So you have locations right over here, so you can have more than one answer. Okay, so substernal chest pain is classic, all right? So this is a typical type of pain, and left-sided chest pain is going to be a typical type of pain as well. However, pain in the shoulder blades or the upper abdomen is going to be atypical in patients with acute coronary syndrome. So let's think about the other signs and symptoms that might be associated with acute coronary syndrome. Well, you have shortness of breath. The patient might complain of indigestion or palpitations and so on. So these are going to be other types of or atypical types of symptoms for acute coronary syndrome. It might also be pain in the shoulders, in the elbows, in the axilla. I've had patients say that I'm having pain in my ears, which are going to be atypical signs and symptoms of ACS. All right, so whenever we have a patient presenting with signs and symptoms of acute coronary syndrome, which includes, of course, your chest pain, the first things that the nurse has to do is to obtain an ECG. And this ECG has to be interpreted within 10 minutes. Okay? And so it's important, therefore, to obtain the ECG as soon as possible so that we can determine if we're dealing with a semi or a non-semi or an unstable angina pectoris. So when we look at the ECG, we're going to look at this particular pattern. So as you could see in the illustration below, that there is an elevation of the ST segment. And what do I mean by the ST segment? Well, this is the ST segment right here, the one that the waveform that connects the S wave to the T wave. This is the baseline. All the ST segment should be at the baseline, but over here it's elevated. So this is going to be a non-semi. And so the criteria is that we must have ST elevations in at least two or more anatomically contiguous leads or related leads. And then in non-semi, as you could see, there's going to be ST depression or T-wave inversions. Okay, so that's one distinction that we do, and that's the reason why we need to obtain an ECG as soon as possible. Okay, I have a 12-lead ECG over here. So you have a patient that arrives, or you are taking care of this patient. You know that the algorithm for treating patients with acute coronary syndrome is that you have to obtain an ECG within 10 minutes of presentation. Okay, so if you take a look at this ECG, do you see any patterns that tells you that there's ST segment elevation? Do you see ST elevation in at least two leads? Yes, okay. So let me ask you, do you see it in lead one? So this is lead one. Is there ST elevation in lead one? No, very good. How about in lead two? Here's lead two. Is there ST elevation in lead two? Yes, okay. So we have one over there. How about in lead three? Do we have ST elevations in lead three? Yes, very good. So how about AVL? Do we have ST elevation in AVL? Here's AVL right here. No, okay. How about AVF right over here? Yes, okay. So this is a semi. We have semi. So we have to act quickly because now we have identified semi. And we'll talk about what you're going to have to do whenever you identify this. Okay, so let's do another one. Okay, do you see ST elevations over here? Okay, lead one, do you have ST elevation? Do you see ST? No, okay. So this is the baseline, and you see that you have T waves that are inverted. How about lead two? Oh, lead three. Yeah, lead two, right over here. No. How about lead three? No. Okay, so we can go on and on. So, do we have semi over here or non-semi? Semi or non-semi? Non-semi. Very good. Excellent, excellent. All right. So, let's go to another question. Okay, so the correct answer here is letter C. You remember, within 10 minutes. That's a very, very critical time factor for you to intervene in patients presenting with symptoms of acute coronary syndrome. Okay, so there are several ECG parameters that we look for therefore. And so the first one is ST segment, and we are going to say that in a semi, it is going to be elevated. In non-semi, it's going to be depressed. And how about in acute coronary, acute angina pectoris, unstable angina pectoris, there's going to be depressed as well. Okay, and how about the T waves? Well, in non-semi, there's going to be inverted, and unstable angina pectoris is going to be inverted as well. Okay, this one is not as important in a 12 lead, I mean, in a semi. Now, there are other things that ECGs could tell us. If you have a Q wave is, let's say that this is a baseline and a waveform that goes down and goes back up. This is a Q wave. And sometimes Q waves are going to be abnormal. If they're very big, it is abnormal. It usually is a normal finding, but it should be, small. Okay, so similar to that one. But let's say you had a Q wave like this, it's bigger than your R wave. This is going to be abnormal. This suggests that there is an old MI. Okay, old MI. All right, what's your answer over here? Okay, so remember, a pathologic or abnormal Q wave is a sign of an old infarction. All right, great. So let's now go to laboratory work. Now, if you have meat, you bought meat and you came back from the grocery store and you were unpacking all the things, but you forgot the meat and you just left it on the counter. 2 days later, you smell something. What happens to the meat that you bought? Describe to me what happens to that meat. it's going to be spoiled, right? It's going to turn black. Well, similarly, when you have death of cardiac tissue, what happens is that if this were part of the ventricles that's dead, it's going to release enzymes. And these enzymes are biomarkers, which we could measure, therefore. Okay, so a biomarker means to say that there is a presence of something that we can measure in order to determine if there has been death. And the biomarkers that we're going to be looking at is actually many biomarkers. And it used to be that we are going to rely on creatinine kinase or CK, but nowadays we rely more on this one, on cardiac troponin, but I'll come back to that one in a little bit. Let's say that I'm having at this time an acute occlusion of my coronary arteries. That means to say that there's going to be immediate death of cardiac tissue within 10 minutes. Shortly thereafter, the enzyme that rises or the biomarker that rises is marked letter A. And this letter A is actually myoglobin. So myoglobin is the first cardiac enzyme to rise whenever there is cardiac death. However, it's not a very reliable test because it disappears almost immediately. Okay? So it actually disappears in almost going to be one day. So it's not a very, very good test to rely on. Okay. Now, the other enzyme or the other biomarker that rises is what is known as creatinine kinase. Now, creatinine kinase is an enzyme, likewise, so CK, creatinine kinase. This is going to be a enzyme, ACE is enzyme, that is released with death of muscle tissue. But there are several tissues wherein it could rise. So it could rise in muscles. Let's say now that you hit yourself on the steering wheel and you're going to have damage of your muscles, skeletal muscles, your CK is going to rise. It also can rise with cardiac tissue, and it could also rise with brain tissue damage. So let's say that you had a head injury, your CK or creatinine kinase could also rise. So this is going to be very confusing if we have a rise in CK and we do not know where it's coming from. And so there is a test called isoenzyme. The isoenzyme will now distinguish which tissue has been damaged. So if it's muscle tissue, this is what's called CKMM. Your CK myocardial band is going to rise. If it's cardiac, it's CKMB, myocardial band. And if it is the brain tissue that's going to be damaged, then you will have a rise in CKBB. Okay, so let me repeat that. Supposing that I had a CVA, which CK enzyme or which creatinine kinase is going to be elevated? BB, very good. If I was hit in my muscles, in my skeletal muscles, by somebody accidentally, which CK is going to rise? MM, okay, very good. And if I have a heart attack, what's going to rise? CKMB, okay, very good. So now you understand what CKMB is going to be. But the unfortunate thing is, CKMB also will disappear within 2 to 3 days. Now, we want something that we can monitor over a period of time, and therefore, the test that is now the gold standard for determining cardiac injury is cardiac troponin. And cardiac troponin is going to be significant if it is above 0.40 nanograms per milliliter. Excuse me. Okay, so that's the gold standard. So if the cardiac troponin is greater than 0.40, then that means to say that there has been cardiac damage. All right, so that's the way we find out, therefore, if a patient has had a myocardial infarction and the troponin levels are going to rise in both STEMI as well as non-STEMI. What other tests are we going to do if a patient presents themselves with signs and symptoms of ACS? Well, CBC is going to be very important. Why is CBC important? Well, we know that anemia is a very common cause of acute coronary syndrome. When you lack oxygen in the blood, therefore it will cause ischemia, and therefore, this is going to be a very useful test to determine if the ACS is due to anemia. BMP, or basic metabolic panel, we usually do this in order to determine or evaluate the blood glucose, renal function, as well as electrolytes. And there are also additional new biomarkers. An example of that is your BNP, or your brain natriuretic peptide, and the N-terminal pro-BNP. These are elevated in acute MI, and they also are going to tell us how much damage there has been as far as the cardiac injury is concerned. Okay? So these are emerging biomarkers. All right, your answers. Very good. So the correct answer is your cardiac troponin, letter C. Okay. We could also do CKMB, but you remember the gold standard is going to be cardiac troponin. Other diagnostic measures that we could implement as far as patients with ACS would be diagnostic imaging. And when I say diagnostic imaging, it would include chest radiography. Why do we want a chest X-ray? Well, this could tell us whether or not the heart is enlarged, for example, or enlargement of the heart is known as cardiomegaly, or it may reveal if the patient has pulmonary edema, which is a frequent or a common complication associated with myocardial infarction. Echocardiography is also going to be very, very important, in the sense that they're going to reflect how the walls of the ventricles are going to function. And so any abnormalities of wall motion will point to the fact that there might be a death of cardiac tissue. Myocardial perfusion imaging, as well as cardiac angiography and CT angiography, are all other things that could be done in order to diagnose acute coronary syndrome. So let's now go to the nursing interventions as far as approaching an acute coronary syndrome patient. So we are going to now adhere to the algorithms that have been published by the American College of Cardiology and the American Heart Association. So Whenever we have, as we see over here, a patient that is presenting with signs of ischemia, then the primary assessment and care, which would be something that paramedics would do, or if you are going to be the first responder, let's say you have a patient and they develop chest pain, these are the things that you would do. You would support ABCs, airway, breathing, and circulation. And then, of course, you monitor the ECG. And you need to evaluate or obtain and evaluate, I should say, a 12-lead ECG within 10 minutes. And then, of course, establish an IV. And now you're going to give the appropriate pharmacologic interventions, which would include the acronym MONA. So MONA is an acronym for you to remember the things that you need to do whenever you have a patient that's having chest pain. And they do not necessarily have to be in this order, okay? So M is for morphine, O is for oxygen, N is for nitroglycerin, and A is for aspirin. And we'll talk more about these in detail later on. So you're going to consider your IV access as well as MONA, which is morphine, oxygen, nitroglycerin, and aspirin. Okay, so we're going to focus now over on this area right over here, because it simplifies what you need to do. You need to obtain the vital signs, and you want to make sure that you provide or evaluate or monitor the O2 saturation. If it is less than 94%, then the patient is going to need oxygen. All right. So let me emphasize something over here. We do not automatically give patients with symptoms of ACS oxygen. And the reason why is because oxygen is a vasoconstrictor, or oxygen causes vasoconstriction. And if you already have a constricted artery, you certainly don't want to do that. Okay? So remember that oxygen is only given whenever the patient's oxygen saturation is less than 94%. Then IV access, 12-lead ECG in 10 minutes, a physical exam, a portable chest x-ray within 30 minutes. This is imperative. And as I said, the reason why we do that is that could tell us the size of the heart, as well as the presence of heart failure, which is a complication, an early complication of myocardial infarction. And look at this. All patients that present with acute coronary syndrome has to receive a non-enteric coated chewable aspirin. So again, it is a chewable aspirin. We ask the patient to chew this. So therefore, if it is going to be chewable, it should be non-enteric coated so that it could be absorbed rapidly, sublingually. Okay? So all patients, except for those who are allergic to aspirin, should have chewable aspirin. This is preferred as this promotes rapid absorption into the bloodstream and therefore achieves a faster therapeutic level. Nitroglycerin and of course, narcotic for pain, and the narcotics that we could give them for pain include fentanyl, morphine, and Dilaudid. All right, so these are the three things that you need to do, or the four things. You need to stabilize to relieve the pain. And we're going to start antithrombic therapy with the administration of your aspirin as well as to monitor ECG. And again, analgesics and sedation. Analgesics could be given, and this is going to be in the form of either morphine, Dilaudid, or any other types of analgesics. But morphine is the ideal one because you could give it in small doses, right? And of course, nitrates and oxygen is a question mark because you only should start oxygen whenever there is a decrease in the O2 saturation of 94%. In that case, you can start the oxygen at 2 liters per minute. All right, so what are some of the other drugs that are going to be commonly used in patients with ACS? Well, antiplatelet drugs. What's the purpose of these antiplatelet drugs? Well, these are going to decrease the clumping of blood and therefore decreases occlusion of other blood vessels. So the most common one is, of course, aspirin. But there are also other kinds, such as your adenosine diphosphate inhibitors, such as clopidogrel, ticagrelor, ticlopidine, and prasugrel. And as listed over here, you could also have abciximab, eftifibatide, and tirofiban. All these are going to be things that is going to block substances that helps clot stick together. And therefore, it's going to prevent additional occlusion of arteries. The other drugs that we give is going to be ACE inhibitors. ACE inhibitors are going to be very, very important as they reduce mortality. And so you can easily identify what an ACE inhibitor is because they always have the suffix pril, okay? So your captopril, your lisinopril, and all other drugs that ends with pril, they are all going to be your ACE inhibitors. You could also have ARBs or angiotensin receptor blockers, and they're easily identifiable by the suffix sartan, like candesartan, valsartan, and so on. And beta blockers are going to be also recommended for anybody that has had a myocardial infarction. And the reason why beta blockers are going to be effective is because they decrease cardiac oxygen demand. So they are recommended for anybody who has had a myocardial infarction. And they're easily identifiable because they all start or end, I should say, with the suffix -ol, like timolol, carvedilol, propranolol, and so on. Okay. And lastly, the other drugs that could be given to these patients are statin drugs. Statin should be initiated early in all patients having no contraindications. And statins are easily identified because they all end with the suffix statin. All right, a good mnemonic to remember the medications that you're going to do or to give in patients with acute coronary syndrome is Monarch Basic. And if you think about it, Mona, we already talked about that. M is for morphine, O for oxygen, N for nitrates, and A for aspirin. But you could also think about the other things that we are going to do as interventions, and they include reperfusion. So what is reperfusion therapy? We'll come back to that one later on. So you remember that myocardial infarction, either STEMI or non-STEMI, is going to be characterized by a total occlusion of a blood vessel. So when there is total occlusion of a blood vessel, we could do two things, and we could do a mechanical procedure to remove the clot, or we could have a chemical intervention to lyse or to dissolve the clot. Okay. So mechanically, we could go in there into the coronary artery and we could remove this blood clot. And sometimes we would put a wire over here or a stent in order to keep it open. This is what's called a PTCA or a percutaneous, which means to say it's through the skin, coronary, so that means to say the heart, angioplasty. Angio is blood vessel, and plasty is repair of the blood vessel. So this is one intervention. Now, the other thing is to remove the clot by chemical means. Now, there's a difference between anticoagulant, which would not be useful in this case because there are already blood clots that have obstructed the blood vessel. What we need is a thrombolytic agent, something that can dissolve the blood clot. And so what are the thrombolytic agents that we always use? Well, they always end with A's. Alteplase, for example, streptokinase, those are thrombolytic agents. And so what they do is they dissolve existing blood clots. Of the two, this one is going to be preferred, particularly in patients with STEMI. All right. Okay, so going back to this then, reperfusion is going to be very important. It's either going to be thrombolytic agents or primary percutaneous coronary intervention. It's PCI, percutaneous, again, through the skin, coronary intervention. All right, C is for clopidogrel, as well as H for heparin, and B, the basic beta blockers, anticoagulants, S is for statin, I for inhibitors of angiotensin, meaning to say ACE inhibitors, or ARBs, and these are the ones that ends with pril, and these ones are the ones that end with sartan. And then, of course, lastly, correction of risk factors. Okay, please answer this one. Okay, so the correct answer is letter D. You remember that the American College of Cardiology and the American Heart Association recommends that aspirin be given as soon as possible after a patient complains of signs and symptoms of ACS. And of course, it's going to be a non-enteric coated and it should be chewable. Okay, and the dose is anywhere from 162 to 325 milligrams. So letter D is going to be the correct answer over here. All right, how about this one? Sure. OK, Okay, answer this one first, and then we'll go back to the dosage for the aspirin. Okay, so the correct answer here is letter C. It decreases the cardiac work and the myocardial oxygen demand. All right, so we talk about aspirin as being a non-enteric coated and non-enteric coated, and it should be chewable, right? Because this is going to provide us with rapid absorption. And the dose is anywhere from 162 to 325 milligrams. And this is dependent upon the weight of the patient. Okay? You're welcome. All right, please answer this one. Very good. The reason why we favor morphine sulfate is that it actually can be given in small doses from 2 milligrams all the way to 6 milligrams with each injection. Very good. So the correct answer is letter B, 94%. Okay, very good. So you remember that Lovenox or enoxaparin is going to be given subcutaneously, usually every 12 hours, and is going to be continued until the PCI is going to be done. All right. So this is a reperfusion therapy. And as I said, there are two ways in which we could reperfuse. One is going to be thrombolytic therapy if the hospital does not have a cardiac catheterization laboratory. But primary PCI is going to be recommended in those individuals that are brought to a hospital that is going to be to have cardiac catheterization. Particularly, it should be done within 12 hours of the onset of symptoms. And it is recommended within 90 minutes or less of arrival into your area. Okay, so 90 minutes and given within 12 hours of symptom onset. That's going to be the criteria or the recommendation of the American College of Cardiology and American Heart Association. Now, if you take a look at this particular cardiac catheterization visuals right over here, we see that there is a total obstruction in this area. And now let's say that we reperfuse that area. Look, that we have now reestablished circulation, and hopefully the amount of tissue death that is going to or have occurred would be less, as far as these interventions are concerned, either with a thrombolytic agent or with a primary PCI. Very good. Letter B is the correct response. Now, some of you might be wondering, what is, I mean, not letter B, letter C is the correct response. I'm sorry. Some of you might be wondering, what is the difference between primary and rescue? Well, rescue PCI means to say that we had tried a thrombolytic agent. So, thrombolytic agent, did not work. And now we're going to go to PCI. So primary PCI is the preferred treatment of STEMI. All right. What is the intervention for PCI in patients with STEMI? How many minutes? Okay, so the correct answer is within 90 minutes. Within 90 minutes. Okay, within 90 minutes after the patient's first contact in the emergency room or with you, if it could not be done within 90 minutes, then fibrinolytic therapy should be initiated within 120 minutes. All right. What do you think is an absolute contraindication to fibrinolytic therapy? Very good. Anytime a patient has had an intracranial hemorrhage, this is going to be a contraindication to fibrinolytics, which tells me that there are some other kinds of contraindications for the administration of fibrinolytics. Anytime the patient has had intracranial hemorrhage, if they have a structural problem like an AV malformation in the brain, a malignant neoplasm in the brain, as well as ischemic stroke within 3 months, and aortic dissection suspicion, active GI bleeding, significant head trauma, intracranial surgery, uncontrolled hypertension, and for streptokinase prior treatment within the previous 6 months. Those are going to be the contraindications for fibrinolytic agents. What I want you to know is that anytime there has been a brain injury, the risk is that if you give thrombolytic agents, it might cause bleeding in the brain. And therefore, you don't want to give a thrombolytic agent with any history of a stroke or intracranial hemorrhage or AV malformation. Now, we've talked about ACS as being caused by coronary artery disease, but there are also other causes of myocardial infarction. One such cause is cocaine as well as methamphetamine-induced acute coronary syndrome, which I have already talked about earlier. And the other type of situation that could cause an acute myocardial infarction is what is known as vasospastic angina. And this is also known as Prinz Metals angina. Now, the problem in Prinz Metals angina is not a narrowing of coronary arteries, but rather, if this were the coronary arteries, there's going to be severe spasms, which causes a temporary occlusion of the area. And this is why it's called vasospastic angina. It's a spasm or vasospasm of the coronary arteries. So whenever there's vasospasm, the affected artery will tighten and narrow, and therefore the blood flow through that artery is going to be significantly reduced. Now, Prinzmetal's metals angina is, or vasospastic angina, is best treated by calcium channel blockers. Calcium channel blockers. Okay, so here's a question. Okay, so your calcium channel blockers are of two kinds, and they're called dihydropyridines, dihydropyridines, and the other one is non-dihydropyridines. Okay, so these ones are the ones that are going to be they're the ones that end with dipine. So an example of that would be nifedipine, that's a calcium channel blocker, amlodipine, and so those are the more common dihydropyridines, amlodipine. Now, the other kind of non-dihydropyridines are going to be your verapamil and diltiazem. Okay, so the correct answer here is letter A. Metoprolol is a beta blocker, simvastatin is a statin, and arone means to say that this is an anti-arrhythmic agent. Okay. All right. So that ends the discussion. So now let's apply what we had talked about in a case study. And this is exactly what might come out in your examination or similar to it in the Nclex, in the new generation Nclex. So we're going to take a look at this case study, and here is the presenting information. You have a 60-year-old male admitted to the emergency room with crashing sternal pain, radiating down the left arm that is worse with walking. Pain began 2 hours ago while walking outside. Client also reports shortness of breath with activity, reports taking a regular aspirin on the way to the hospital. Vitals, temperature 99, heart rate 110, respirations 22, blood pressure 160 over 90, pulse oximeter 93%, on room air, chest pain 8 over 10, weight reported at 280 pounds or 127 kilograms with a BMI of 35, started on unit chest pain protocol, O2 applied, and nitroglycerin given. A peripheral IV has been in place in the client's left arm, morphine given, and labs were drawn. And now the diagnostics show us the ECG shows sinus tachycardia, a rate of 110 beats per minute, and an ST segment elevation in leads V3 and V4. Okay? So as you could see, there's ST segment elevation right over here and right over there. All right. Okay, so let's go to the next slide. And the laboratory report tells you this. Okay, so the good thing about Nclex now is that whenever they give you the laboratory results, they will give you a reference range. So you do not have to memorize necessarily the laboratory values that are normal. Okay, so the cholesterol is 250. And as you could see, the normal range is less than 200. So this is elevated, isn't it? Okay. WBC is 4.5 to 10.5. So this is okay. The platelets are 400,000. So that is also okay. The potassium is 3.9. So it's also okay. The sodium is 140. That's okay. The magnesium is 1.5. That's also okay. And troponin, look. So this is going to be elevated as well. And your creatinine kinase, myocardial band, is elevated as well. So what are you thinking of now? So whenever you see this preliminary information, you need to think about what could be happening right now. So what is your suspicion is happening? What is your diagnosis so far? You remember there was ST elevation in V3 and V4. So this is going to be semi, isn't it? So you need to think about semi. All right. So the next slide asks you, the nurse reviews the diagnostic and laboratory findings. Which two findings are most significant? Okay, so your troponin and CK, very good. Your troponin and CK or the ECG? You remember the troponin and CK are showing the same things. All right? So in the troponin, you already established that there's cardiac damage. But there's one other thing that is going to be very important over here because it now tells you that what you're talking about or what you're seeing is semi, ST elevation MI, okay? So don't choose E and F because E is going to be the same as CK, all right? So the ECG and the troponin are going to be indications that there has been a cardiac damage to the muscles and the heart muscles and should be addressed immediately. And we know that elevated troponin is specific for myocardial injury. Okay. All right. Let's go to the next one. For each client finding, click to specify whether the finding is consistent with STMI, non-STMI, or unstable angina. Each column must have at least one option selected. So in order for us to do that, let's go ahead and do it this way, okay? So what would show that there's ST elevation? What would show that there's ST elevation MI? Okay. All right. So would you have letter A? Is letter A going to tell you whether or not there's ST elevation MI? Yes or no? Yes or no? Okay. So creatinine kinase, definitely, it tells us that there has been an ST elevation MI. Now, an ST elevation MI, would you have crushing chest pain? Yes or no? Yes, okay. Would you have ECG changes? Yes. Would you have elevated cholesterol? Is this a risk factor? Yes. Could you have obesity? Yes. And could you have troponin T? So in answering this question, on semi, you would be checking all these. How about in non-semi? Would you have an increase in creatinine kinase? Would you have an increase in creatinine kinase in non-semi? Yes. Okay, so we check that. Would we have crushing chest pain on non-semi? Yes. Would we have ECG changes? Yes, very good. Would we have elevated cholesterol? Yes, obesity and troponin T. Yes, yes, yes. Okay. Now, if we have unstable angina, would we have an increase in your creatinine kinase? No, okay. And would we have crushing chest pain? Yes. Would we have the ECG change, which was ST elevation? No, okay. So we should not have had this. There should be no ST elevation, I'm sorry. How about the elevated cholesterol? Yes. Obesity, yes. How about troponin? No. Okay. So troponin would be no. Okay, let me just erase that. For those who are going to visit the recording, they might get confused. Okay? So right over there. Okay. So now let's go to the next question. Complete the following sentence by selecting from the list. The nurse should recognize that the client is most likely experiencing what? Letter B, ST elevation MI. Very good. And complete the sentence. The nurse should recognize that the client is most likely experiencing A, an XXS caused by an artery, coronary artery blockage. Artery what? Blockage. Okay, very good. And then we're going to... The client receives a diagnosis of ST elevation MI. For each potential medication order, click to specify whether the medication is indicated or not indicated in the plan of care. So let's go to the indicated ones. Would you give analgesics to this patient? Yes, okay. Would you give antibiotics? No. Okay. Would you give anticoagulants? Yes. Would you give beta blockers? Beta blockers? Yes. You remember, it decreases the damage. Okay. So this is going to be very important. Does the patient need a fluid bolus? No, okay, we don't want to give a bolus. And how about fibrinolytics? Meaning to say, yes, okay. Or thrombolytic agents or fibrinolytic agents. Very good. So The next one is, which ones are not indicated? So we already answered that. So let's go back to that graph over here. So we said that analgesics are going to be indicated. Antibiotics are not indicated. Anticoagulants are indicated. Beta blockers are indicated. Fluid bolus is not indicated. And fibrinolytics are going to be indicated. Okay? All right. So let's now go to the orders. So you have here the orders now, and it includes your enoxaparin, 100 milligrams subcutaneous, metoprolol, 25 milligrams PO, tenecteplase, 50 milligrams IV, morphine sulfate, 2 milligrams IV Q15 minutes as needed for pain. Okay, so the nurse receives the orders. Complete the sentence from the list of drop-down options. Choose one from each box. The nurse should next give what? Which is the next medication that the nurse should give? Okay, so B and C. Okay, the nurse should give first. We are going to, which one of these is going to be much more important? Okay, so you're going to give enoxaparin, which is going to be an antithrombic agent. The other thing is metoprolol, which is the beta blocker, and tenecteplase, what is the place? This is the antithrombic agent, thrombolytic agent or fibrinolytic agent. Okay, so therefore this has got to be given first. You need to do that because it's beneficial to open up the obstruction as soon as possible. Okay, and which should be given immediately upon admission, within 30 minutes of admission, or within 90 minutes of admission. And this has got to be letter E, within 30 minutes of admission. Okay, for PTCA, it has to be 90 minutes. For your thrombolytic agents, it's got to be within 30 minutes of arrival. Okay. So let's go to this one now. We are now given a progress at 10 o'clock. You already had that. So now at 10:30, this is the new one. The vital signs are temperature 99, and in comparison to this one, it's still 99. Heart rate is 120. It was 110 before. And the respiratory rate now is 22, which is unchanged from before. And the blood pressure is 160 over 90 before. It's now 150 over 85. The pulse oximeter, it was 93. It's now 95 on 2 liters of nasal cannula. And the chest pain was 8 over 10 on admission, and it's now 6 over 10. Okay, so you have enoxaparin, metoprolol, tenecteplase, morphine sulfate, 2 milligrams IV, Q15 minutes as needed for pain. All right, so let's see which one has improved or has declined or unchanged. So let's take a look at the pulse. Did the pulse improve, decline, or unchange? So let's go back to here. So the pulse was 110, and now it's 120. So what do you think? Is the pulse improved, decline, or unchanged? Remember, it's from 110, and now it is 120. Is this an improvement, a decline, or unchanged? Very good. This certainly is decline because you remember stress increases heart rate. All right. So let's go back to your blood pressure. The blood pressure was 160 over 90, and now the blood pressure is 150 over 95. So from 160 over 90 to 150 over 95. Is this improved, declined, or is it unchanged? Very good. It certainly has improved, right? Because if the blood pressure is coming down, that means to say that the stress response is going to be less. All right. The pulse oximeter. If we go back to the pulse oximeter, it used to be 93 and now it's 95. So 93 to 95. Is this going to be improved, declined, or unchanged? I don't see your answer. Okay. So it is going to be improved, right? Very good. And the respiratory rate, let's go back to the respiratory rate. Respiratory rate was 22 in the beginning, and now it is 22. So 22 to 22. Is this improved, the same, or unchanged? Okay, unchanged. And the pain. The pain was 8 over 10, and it's now 6 over 10. So 8 over 10 to 6 over 10. So is this improved, declined, or unchanged? All right. So it's improved. Very good. Now, the reason Nclex is asking you to evaluate this is to determine if you could evaluate the interventions, so that you can now therefore know that if the patient is improving, you're going to continue your interventions. If they're declining, then you're going to have to increase or add other interventions. And if it's unchanged, you're going to continue to monitor the patient. All right, so going further, the nurse reassesses the client after initiating the chest pain protocol and giving tenecteplase. For each finding, specify if the finding that indicates the client has improved. We already did that. I'm sorry, unchanged. Okay. So that ends my presentation, actually. But before we go there, I'd like to give you the link because I want you to go to this case study again sometime today or tomorrow or whenever you have the time. But what I'd like for you to do is to answer the questions again as far as the case study is concerned. So the link to that is this one. So let me just, Are you able to copy that? That link? Okay. All right, so appreciate all your attendance. And if you have any questions, please go ahead and ask them now. Don't be shy. We have a few more minutes left of our time, so I'd be glad to answer your questions. Tomorrow, the topic will be heart failure. Okay, so that will be the disease processes that I have selected are those that are most likely to come out in the NCLEX. So has that been helpful at all? You can unmute. Thank you, Cheyenne. How about the others?
Very helpful. Thank you.
Thank you, Marie. Appreciate it. I used to, Cheyenne, so way back in the 1990s, I used to do questions for the Nclex. And for those of you who did not see the introduction, I actually have written an Nclex textbook. And that Nclex textbook is this one, Medical Surgical Nursing Reviews and Rationales, right there. Okay. So that was an Nclex review book. And that's how I got interested in helping people prepare for the Nclex. All right. So I look forward to having you again tomorrow. If you are brave enough to come back, I hope you do. And this is so it will help you be prepared for the Nclex. All right. So thank you once again. Have a great evening. And if you have any questions, please let me know. If you're bashful, just go ahead and type it. If not, have a great evening. I'll see you tomorrow, hopefully. Okay. Bye-bye.